Close it off. So we gotta get one of these.
No volume, yeah.
Alright guys, thanks for coming. Really appreciate it. Again, this time, we apologize for the delay in starting. We usually stream precisely at 12:15. Today we are streaming at 12:21. Right, so, but okay, 60 minutes, I'm sorry. Right, today we are really very fortunate to have Moshe. Right, I think we will have a good time here today. Moshe is an expert in security. He's going to talk about actually startup on the security, security for startups. Right, what I'll do is I probably give the maximum amount of time to him rather than for me to speak. I think most of you guys have heard me speak more than enough. Right. In all the weeks that we've been here. So without further ado, thank you very much.
Thank you. Just how long do I have, Chuck?
An hour.
Yeah. So thank you guys, thank you for inviting me. Let me know if you cannot hear me. Okay, I will use the microphone. But, okay, just again. So thank you for inviting me, thank you for Chuck, thank you for Tal for raising this idea, thank you for the guys from Train Michael, Dr. Ling, and David for arranging this spot and everything. So I think I thank everyone. My name is Moshe Ferber. I come from Israel, as mentioned. I've been into the information security arena for the last 20 years. I started in the Israeli Defense Forces. Later on, I went worked for the corporates, for the large corporates. There's a lot of American corporates in Israel, so I was doing security for some of them. 10 years ago, I moved into entrepreneurship and had my own startups. Some of them were successful, some of them were not so successful, but they had one thing in common. They were all placed on top of a public cloud, which makes me explore and research more this area. This is where I came across the Cloud Security Alliance, and for the last 5 years I've been managing the local branch of the Cloud Security Alliance. I've been doing some of the work for the CCSK, for the CCSP certification, and currently this project that we are working on, which is the cloud security for startups. And this brings me to why am I here. As I said, startups today are placed on top of a public cloud. This is where they grow up in. They usually don't move from there. This is their arena, this is their playground. This is where they can be successful, this is where they can fail. And we noticed that there is a knowledge gap. It's a big gap between what should be done in security in the cloud and what the startup is aware of, what the startup can do, what the startup is aware of, its customer requirements, and we decided to fill this gap. So in the last 6 months, we've been creating a document, which is basically a guidelines for startups. If you scan the barcode, it will lead you to the link. The link is also in the description of this lecture. It basically talks about application security, platform security, and security management. And it talks about from the perspective of a startup lifecycle. We divided the lifecycle into 3 stages. I will repeat that in a second. Just I want to say that I haven't been the only one. I'm going back because I see people miss the barcodes. I want to say that I haven't been the only one that worked on it. So I would like to give a big thank you to Shachar Maor from Outbrain and to Marius from Click Software and Omer from Cyber Ready, Nishri from Volte, Rafael from LivePerson, and Office Modaro from Atis.io. All of them worked on this document. This document is currently moving into second phase, second version, as a formal CSA guidelines for startups. We are now finished the peer review, and I think we will have the formal CSA Security Alliance version going out somewhere late September, early October. So this is about the background of the documents. Why do we need a special guidelines for cloud security? I mean, what is the difference? There are many cloud security checklists, right? Just last week, the Cloud Security Alliance released their version 4 of the cloud security guidelines. What is the difference between all of those checklists? What is the difference between all the knowledge that we already have about cloud security and this document? The thing is that the startup has its own different life cycle. And it's a very different life cycle than a regular enterprise. If you look at checklists for cloud security for a regular enterprise, such as the checklist from NIST or ISO or whatever, they talk in the sentence they will tell you to implement 2-factor authentication, and a security information management product, which is totally two different things in the life cycle of a startup, because two-factor authentication almost costs you nothing. And it also costs you nothing to operate, which is the big cost usually for startups. And SIM product is something that a startup cannot afford until very late stage, until when it's not a startup. It's expensive, it's highly cost from the operative point of view. So basically, the checklists today are adapted to an enterprise that is moving to the cloud. They haven't thought about the different phases that the startup is going in. So the first thing we did in this document is change the way we do security and to the different phases of a startup, which basically means, first step, this is from the beginning. Only an idea, okay? Seed stage, you only have one thing, you still haven't have, and you still haven't developed anything, just thinking about an idea, and all the way to your first customers. Usually, first customers are trusted customers, people you know personally, right? Not customers that are paying money usually, beta site customers, they trust you more, so you can go get away with a little less security than it used to. In the second phase, you're maturing. You already have a product. You are starting to sell it. Customers are paying real money for it. They're expecting real security. So you need to mature. You need to mature your services, but you still you don't have a lot of customers, you don't have a lot of data. You still have to gain the trust. This is the most challenging phase because you have customers, paying customers, you need the trust, but you still don't have a lot of money. And in the third phase, you're mature by now, probably second version. You're now going abroad, not only local customers, you're going to the United States, you're going to Europe maybe. You're starting to deal with customers that really insist on security, enterprise customers maybe. This is the third stage, and you should get, basically you need to be ready when you get to that stage with the right building blocks from stage one. So this is basically the difference in the checklist that we created in this cloud security guidelines, the difference between this document and other documents. And basically this table or this picture is the summary of everything. We're talking about three stages, 1, 2, and 3, and we're talking about the three pillars of security: security management, application security, and platform security. Basically, the first one is how you manage your security, everything that is related to. We'll get to that in a second. I think everybody knows what is security management. Application security is securing your application, basically the product that you build. And platform security, it was used to be called infrastructure security, still called infrastructure security, but it's more today in the cloud world, it is more about securing the platform that you're placed on, the infrastructure or platform as a service that you're located on. I guess in this presentation, I will talk a lot about Amazon, Microsoft, Google, the big three, okay? It's very similar if you're using other providers, but it's easier to talk about Amazon, Google, and Microsoft because most of the people are familiar with them. And the security platform is securing this dashboard and infrastructure. So this, and what you see here is basically the different tools or the different processes and things you need to consider for each stage. So this is the heart of the document, and basically what I'm going to do in the next hour is review this. Now, I mentioned there are three stages, but your life cycle, you can go through these stages faster or slower, and it is very dependent on your product. For instance, how mature you are, right? What kind of data you collect. If you're just collecting marketing data, public data, you can do your security slower. People will ask you less questions. But if you collect personal identifiable information or personal data, you wouldn't have to move through the phases faster. And if you're collecting sensitive data, which is a unique criteria inside PII, like political views or health data, all of this is considered sensitive, you will have to move faster second and first stage will arrive faster. It depends on the market sector you are in. If you're selling to enterprise, financial, or government customers, they will expect you to have ISO 27001 certification on a very early stage. If your customer is marketing or I don't know, let's say retail companies, expect PCI but not ISO 27001. So there will be less concern about your security certification. So the market sector you're working with really affects the way, how fast you need to adopt those different stages, and of course intrusiveness. If you're a startup that is pulling out major chunks of data from your customers, if you're located inside a data center, it's very different. For instance, if you're located on the public website, very different how you interact with your customers and where are you located inside the networks. So again, if you're really intrusive, taking out a lot of your customers' data, expect those phases to be really fast. If you're non-intrusive, outside, away from the data center or your customers, expect the life cycle to be slower. And let's start to analyzing it from phase one. Phase one, make sure that you get your building blocks correctly. With which building blocks? Authentication, separation, access. First thing that the startup does is choosing his cloud providers. And you need to check them, and you need to evaluate them carefully. I'm not talking about your software as a service, like where you store your emails or where you store your code. I'm talking about the platform that you're going to develop upon, like the infrastructure or platform as a service. Again, today, things you need to consider. Location. If you want to sell to customers in Brazil, it would be easier if your provider has a data center in Brazil. Certification. If you're if you need to certify to a very specific certification, let's say you're a startup that is doing arms dealing. It's a complicated concept. Let me rephrase. Let's try something simpler. Let's say you are collecting medical data from United States customers. You need your provider to be HIPAA compliant. Otherwise, it will be very hard to do your own HIPAA compliance on top of a non-HIPAA provider. HIPAA is the law in the United States to deal with medical records. Okay. I haven't mentioned it. Ask questions. Just simply raise your head and you can ask questions. I have no problem stopping answering questions. I'm not sure the level of knowledge in the room about different certifications, security, cloud aspects. I'm going to throw a lot of terms to the air. Just simply raise your head and ask the question. Third thing you need to consider, ecosystem. You're going to install your software on top of Amazon or Google or some other kind of provider. Is there experts in your surrounding that are familiar with this platform? You will need help. Most of your challenges will be solved by external consultants. Remember, you're a startup. At this point, you're two or three people, the founders, maybe a hired programmer. You cannot do it all, so you use a lot of external consultants. If you're using this special BI feature from Microsoft, is there someone to support you in the process? So the question of an ecosystem is about the expertise in your surrounding and the tools and products that the cloud provider will bring. Now, there are many other aspects choosing your cloud provider, price, services, SLA, not related to security, so I'm putting them aside. From the security point of view, think of those three. Enough expert to secure your platform, this is the ecosystem, the certification and standards that the provider is complying to, and the location of the data, of his data centers. Those are basically the three major aspects of choosing your cloud provider from the security point of view. I must say that today, I don't see a reason why not going to one of the big three or four, IBM, Microsoft, Google, or Amazon. I think you need a good reason not to use one of them. This is not a commercial for those providers. I have no relations with that provider. Just the thing is, they are mature, they know how to do security, there's a lot of data centers, they have a lot of certification, and the knowledge and ecosystem around them is better. So today, if someone is telling me that he's thinking of not going to one of those providers, I will have to ask him if he made, if he's considered both aspects. What else from the first stage? First stage, application security is your thing to consider, is the most important thing. Why? It's hardest to fix later. If you make mistake at the application security level, it's the hardest to fix at later stage. Infrastructure security, you're on the cloud. The infrastructure is scalable, it's flexible. You can always fix it, you can always move your servers from different services. But if you mess up with your authentication, with your identity scheme, then it will be much harder to fix later. Where is your areas of focus? Authentication and authorization of your users, password management, password policy. Think not only about the technology way, the way that you handle session cookies, encryption cookies. There's a lot of information about how to do it correctly from the technical point of view, persistent cookies and all of this. Think also about the process behind the scenes. How your user will change password. The process, not the technology. Most of the failures in identity is around changing your password. Okay, some lack of controls verifying the user when it's changing the password, and the account is hijacking. Session management, input validation, secure queries, logs, all of this is part of the application security. Those stuff you need to do at day one. When you start developing your application, those are the things that you need to consider. It's mostly around the identity. Using Federation Protocol will help you. We'll get to that in a later stage. Start to implement something that is called SDLC, Software Development Lifecycle. Now, SDLC is a big word. I'm not familiar with many companies that are able to do full SDLC. It's surely not a startup can do a full SDLC. But SDLC also has a building block. The first building block is something that is called threat modeling. One of the most popular threat modeling is Stride from Microsoft. Use it on every significant feature. What is a significant feature? This is for you to decide. But for every significant feature, use the Stride model to evaluate the risk, threat modeling, and also for every new version release. This is free. There's a lot of information from Microsoft about using Stride available on the website for everyone. You just simply have to download it. There's a lot of card games that you can give to your developers. There's a lot of knowledge you can let them read. It's all free. Use it. Again, nothing here costs money, simply an investment. When is the right point to start with this? Usually you have two or three founders, right? Then they recruit the next programmer, then the next programmer. The next one should go into the full process of SDLC. Why? Because you want to make sure that they start tabula rasa, they start as a clean board and not bringing in errors from the past. So all of those procedures, start working them when you start implementing them, when you start to hire people into your startup. When you bring external people, not the founders, you find it hard to put security procedures to the founders, right? It's an early stage. You cannot really separate between production and development, they are all the same. You cannot really separate between job roles, everybody doing the same. But from the employee, from the third or fourth employee, this is where you start to implement those procedures. Identity access management, this is around the cloud dashboard. The cloud dashboard is the most intimidating attack vector for a young startup. There was a company called CodeSpaces, a mid-sized company, not even a startup, it was like on stage three, code versioning website. You can store your code in different versions. They are the reason we started this document. because code spaces got hacked, like somebody who wants to simply wanted money in exchange of returning them their access keys. They refused, and he simply deleted them. The company was vanished in 2 hours. Okay, 2 hours after the attack was started, the website was gone. They had a simple HTML saying, "We got hacked. We lost all your data. We don't have external cloud backups. We are sorry. We're going out of business." Just like that, the company was gone in after 2 hours of a hack. So the dashboard is the most intimidating attack vector, and you need to protect it. First of all, you don't work with the master account. This is Codespaces' number one mistake. When you enlist to Amazon or Azure or Google Compute Engine, you have a master account, a root account. You never use it. You put it in the safe. Why? Because it's a master account. It has all of the privileges. You create sub-users, you create sub-accounts. Today you can even create different accounts and connect them, and then you use them. You do multi-factor authentication on your production users. At this point in time, I think you do multi-factor authentication for all users. It simply doesn't cost anything. Everybody has a mobile phone. You can invest a couple of dollars in a plug-in USB key, multi-factor authentication. You need to rotate your access keys periodically and apply good policy. A word about access keys. About 40% of cloud hacks came from misplaced access keys, API keys. API keys are just like password, only they travel with your code. You put them inside your code because your servers, your processes need to access them. If you put it in the wrong way, if you store it inside a configuration file that is located on disk, you can eventually end up uploading it to GitHub in mistake. And statistics says 36 hours after you made such a mistake of uploading your API keys to GitHub, somebody will find them and use them. Hackers continuously sweep code repositories looking for API keys. And this is what happened to Codespaces. Configuration file, API key accidentally goes to GitHub, and game is over. So there's a lot of best practices around keeping API keys. Make sure you stick to them. I said 40% of cloud hacks is around API keys. I'm talking about IaaS and PaaS, not software as a service. Other 40% of cloud hacks is object storage. Microsoft Log, Google Cloud Files, Amazon S3, all of this is object storage. It's a great place to store your data. You throw your data in, you can access it from API, you can access it by HTTP. The only problem is, when something doesn't work, programmers tend to do right-click and do make public, just to, you know, troubleshoot. And then they forget to close this public data. And the next thing you see is the headline. Just 2 weeks ago, headline in all of the biggest newspapers in the United States, 12 million Verizon customers' data details were found on Amazon website. Exactly what happened. A company, in this specific case it was Nice Systems, an Israeli company, provided service to Verizon. The service was located on Amazon S3. Somebody, probably for troubleshooting, just did a right click, make public. He said, let's see if it works when it's public. And then the next thing is CNN headlines. And a lot of trouble for Nice and Verizon as well. So 40% of cloud hacks S3, 40% API vectors, other 20% various things. So take care of your object storage, take care of your API keys. At this point, it doesn't cost any money. Simply configuration details. One thing about controls. I'm talking now, I'm moving from the technology a little bit to the philosophical point of the things. We have different type of controls. We have preventative controls, like firewalls, antivirus. We have detective controls, like intrusion prevention systems. We have corrective controls, which is like patches and incident response, right? If something happens, we do incident response to correct it. And we have compensatory controls, audits, checkups, disaster recovery, right? What is compensating controls? I cannot guarantee that the ransomware will not encrypt my old files. So I can do backup as a compensating control. There are four types of controls. Traditionally, preventative controls and compensating controls are less expensive, they're cheaper. Detective controls and corrective controls are more expensive. I'm not even talking about the cost of the tool, I'm talking about the operational cost. How much manpower, how many people you need to operate it. Detective controls, expensive tools, a lot of man hours operating, configuring, tweaking it, same for corrective controls. Preventative controls, they are really annoying, but they are simple and cheap to use, right? So instead of investing in detective controls, invest more in compensating or preventative. What does it mean in practical? Create different users for each environment, something that is really trivial. But we tend to, since we are a startup, we have one person that is doing a lot of roles. We give them one user. No. Force him to log out from the test account and log in back to the production account. Or use the same account. Very annoying, very effective, cheap. Compensatory controls. I mentioned that somebody made a right click on object storage, made public. The data is now public. The best way to detect it is not detective controls, which are more complicated. Once in every while, take out the list of your directories in your object storage and see if it's public or not. See who has access to it. Do a regular checkup, a regular audit. The cloud provider are getting better in giving you this service. Okay, they give you better ways to audit, spot configuration changes. This is all improving, so use it. Bottom line, those are the compensating controls you want to use at this stage. Activate billing alert. Every cloud provider has it. It's easy to operate. It will give you the best indication if somebody is using your environment for something else. AWS has a great tool that is called AWS Config. Microsoft and Google has similar tools, or they will send out similar tools. Use it, and of course, all cloud provider will give you logs. The first thing you need to do is activate those logs. I see so many environments that haven't been even activated. I'm not talking about collecting them into a special analysis stuff. Simply activate them, so if something happens, that's a compensating control to look at the logs. Last thing, backups. Okay, don't be code spaces. First of all, it's very easy. Take your data from the cloud and store it locally every couple of months, just so you'll have a very cold backup. With your maturity, you're maturing, you're moving more and more into an active secondary site, right? This is like a process. Very cold external backup all the way up to active secondary sites. You have a couple of years to work this out, okay? But continue improve your backups all on this scale. This is for stage one. Now we're moving into stage two. In stage two, you focus on your operational security. As I said, first, on this first stage, focus on your application security because it's the hardest to get right. On second stage, you're growing, you're adding customers. They need to see operational security. They need to make sure that their data is safe in your hands. First of all, at this point, your team is growing. You're no longer a couple of founders in the basement. You have a big team, bigger team, not big yet. You have a bigger team, and you need to do two things. First of all, beef up your access controls and separations. Now you have development and operations, development of production. Now there are two different departments. By now, it should be two different departments. you separate them with access controls. Again, this is what happened to code spaces. They were not separated. Second, awareness training. Doesn't cost a lot. There's great tools in the internet. Teach your developers, your QA department. QA department plays a big role in security because they can activate security testing, which is something not all companies do. But it's a big change in the way that your security is treated. So make sure that you invest in their security training. Today there are numerous platforms, websites, knowledge sharing websites about this. Use them. Your identity management, I'm talking about your application identity management. Before that I was talking about the cloud platform. Now your identity management, your application, it should support customer use cases. What does that mean? Customer don't want you to hold their identities. They will want you to connect to their Active Directory, to their identity stores. So you need to support federation protocol like SAML, OpenID, OAuth. This requirement will come from the market. Your customer will come and tell you, support our use cases. Don't invent your own identity scheme. So, again, learn the standards, integrate them into your software. Other things you need to consider at this point. Create security policy. Enterprise customer will not let you handle their data without some kind of, without some form of transparent security policy. This is how I do security. It's not a one pager, but it also doesn't have to be that fake. Couple of pages describing your operational security, your application security. How do you handle your data? How do they handle their data? How do you do incident response? There's resources in the internet, but create something, not copy and paste, create something out of your own, because you will need to stand for it with your customers. They will ask you questions. You need to also, what you're writing there, you need to also be doing. Otherwise, might be not that pleasant. Your back office services are growing. What do you mean back offices? Now you have probably software as a service, such as CRM, Salesforce, or Microsoft Dynamics. You probably use some kind of code repository. You probably use some kind of automated ticketing system for your code. All of these needs to be secured according to your policy. They need to connect to your identity store. They need to be protected by multi-factor authentication. Again, it doesn't cost money, simply configuration details. Pay attention, who can access your code? Who can access your ticketing system? We saw hacks and stuff started from the ticketing system. Somebody put in a ticket. Please upload this API key, And next thing is, game is over. So protect those applications. Use your own BI data. Use the logs and the insights your application is producing, because that would be the great place to identify fraud, scams, unusual behavior from your users. Okay. Today in the cloud, it's very easy to take up your data and throw it into some kind of Elasticsearch or some kind of other data visualization and data management platform, not management, data analysis platform. It's very easy, it's very cheap. Use it and gain insights on your users. It's much, those insights will probably be better than any external firewall or IPS logs, right? Because you don't have a big infrastructure, but you have a lot of users' operations. And finally, do penetration tests. At this point, a customer will ask you, is your application protected? How do you know if it's protected? Take a company with a good reputation, do penetration tests, make sure that you deliver your customer under non-disclosure agreement, give them the report. You might erase details of IP, of servers, but give them a detailed report. It will increase the trust. It is an expense worth having. And if you want to set enterprises, it will be hard not to do it. Make sure that you do it if you're going international, going globally with your customer. Make sure that the company that does the accreditation test is also known globally. It will save you time and questions. Encryption. I'm not talking about encryption of data in motion, because this you should have already done in phase one. Encryption of data in motion is easy. SSL, VPNs, IPsec, very easy. Do it from day one. Encrypting of data traced is harder. First of all, why do you need to encrypt? Or what do you need to encrypt? Today, PII, I think in the next couple of years, it will be a standard to encrypt it. GDPR, the new data protection laws from Europe, basically are, even if they're not saying this specifically, they're basically forcing us to encrypt. This is the best way to avoid many of the GDPR requirements. And so regulation and laws might force you to encrypt. Contracts, your customers might insist on encrypting the data in your contract. And of course, standards such as PCI forces you to encrypt. So be prepared to encrypt. Now the good news is, cloud platforms are getting better encryption, at least in storage level encryption, which is not that effective, but it's better than any other alternative that we have now. So pay attention. There's encrypting of the infrastructure, there's encryption of the data itself. Very different backups. Sorry, very different encryption schemes. It gives you different benefits. Understand the difference between them. Understand the difference between encrypting your volume and encrypting your database. Totally different things. Understand what it will protect you from. Most of the thing we're worried about is our backups getting lost. Encrypting your backups is one of the most important things. And finally, is where you store the keys. Most cloud platforms will give you some kind of a local storage protected by the cloud provider. It might not be good enough for some of your customers. Some of your maybe banks will ask you to store your keys in a specific hardware module called HSM. Again, the large providers, Microsoft, Amazon, IBM, Google, will have this service in place. It costs a lot of money, but for some enterprises, this will be a must. So prepare for that. I think that HSM is stage three, not stage two, but since I'm talking about encryption in general at this point, this is where we are mentioning it. So again, encryption is a big thing. I can talk for 2 hours about how to encrypt your data. This is just the highlights. Another thing you will need to do at stage two is do some better operational security around your host, around your servers. How you access them, it should all be encrypted by VPN, multi-factor authentication. Ongoing patch management, this process should be mature by now. Ongoing servers will go on, ongoing patching. There's Netflix has set up something that is called red black doctoring, which means that you don't upgrade servers. You simply install new one, already patched, and move all your customers to it. This methodology is great. It's a lot of work, automation, but it can prevent all the cycles of patching and testing and patching and testing. Simply, the idea is like this. You need to install a new version. You install a new environment with all the patches. You install the new version of software, and then you slowly move your users to the new environment. You delete all the environment. So it takes away the patching process from the equation. And this is interesting. I'm not saying it's suitable for everybody. It is really for startups who are really a continuous integration, continuous delivery. But we are getting there. And other things that need to be at this point, DDoS protection. It's not expensive. Today it's a commodity. Companies like Cloudflare, Akamai, Replays, Encapsula, they give you for a couple of dollars, they give you DDoS protection for your website, use it. We see more and more dinosaurs on companies without even really good motivation. So you probably will encounter this a certain point. Use the DDoS protection, they'll give you another layer of protection, and also will provide you another many benefits. Content delivery network, caching, SSL termination. It's a good thing to use, it's a good infrastructure to scale into. And we're switching into the phase three. This is where you get more matured. Transparency at this point is crucial. You're starting to have real customers who pay big money, who expect to have more. You need to be transparent on your security. You need to be transparent on how you protect your data. You need to give them disaster recovery policy, backup policy, incident response policy, security policy. All of this is something that your customer will ask you. Be prepared for that. This is where certification might help. Which certifications? I think today ISO 27001 or SOC 2, ASSE 16, if you're familiar with, is a mandatory. If you're selling to enterprise, you will not escape from ISO 27001 or SOC 2 and 3. Probably if you're having credit cards, PCI, what else? You can use certification as a competitive advantage. There are certifications such as ISO 27018, cloud privacy, and 27017, cloud security. Those certifications are not common. You can use them as advantages over your competitors. I'm doing more security. I'm an early adopter of ISO 27018. I'm very good in privacy. You see the big companies do it. Microsoft, first one to adopt 27018. And going public with that. Do the same. Make it a competitive advantage over your customers. In the cloud world, when you're selling to enterprise customer, conscious about security is an advantage. So use it. At this point, your application security needs to be matured. Now, matured is a relative term. As I said, not many enterprises have achieved full security development lifecycle completely. But here are the stages that you need to have. You need to have threat modeling working. You need to have static analysis over significant pieces of code. The trick is startup versus enterprise. This all has to be automated. In enterprise, most enterprises are doing, I don't know, version out of one every 1 month, one every 3 months. So the static analysis and dynamic analysis of the code can be slow and manual. A startup can sometimes do 20 production changes a day, 20 or one major upgrade a week. So all of this process needs to be manual. Sorry, all of this process needs to be automated. You cannot go away with dynamic analysis manually because it has to be 20 changes, production changes a day. You cannot do it manually. So you have to integrate into your code. You have to into your testing procedures. You have to integrate it into your continuous integration. How does it work? Usually, they have some kind of continuous integration server. It will call security testing, also along with the regular testing. Part of the security testing is the dynamic analysis, static analysis. And today, there are more tools available to do that, even free. Free tools that you can download from GitHub with dynamic testing. You can find them on GitHub. Also, as I said, third stage, automation is the key, and security as a service. What is security as a service? Basically, security tools that you acquire as a cloud service. As I mentioned, the DDoS protection, that's a great example of security as a service. Somebody is protecting you from denial of service. Other things that you can use at this point, security information management. Somebody who will install agents on your network, collect the logs, and they will monitor and create the alerts. Usually, enterprise use it on the on-premise. Startup should consume it from external sources. So security as a service popular with startup is key management, DDoS protection, web application firewalls, tokenization for keeping credit cards, right? You don't have to keep credit card data in line to all of PCI standards. You can use somebody else to do that for you. Those are popular services within startups. What am I missing? Anything else? Ah, identity as a service. Basically, don't host your own Active Directory. You can use Okta or Google or Microsoft Azure AD for hosting your identities and then integrate it with all your applications. This is also the time for buying products. Third stage, you should have money by now. Up until now, we avoided, almost avoided, of mentioning any products. Anything was internal or cloud provider services. Now you can implement web application firewalls. Bug bounty is getting popular, even with startups. We know bug bounty is something that Facebook or Google are doing. You see more and more medium-sized companies going bug bounty on a special sector, on a special maybe piece of software, on a special service. They usually use a bug bounty's platform to do so, not developing their own programs. There are a couple of bug bounty platforms that can be used. If you focus on it, they give great values. And DB firewalls. This is also one of the tools that you can implement at this point. And of course, I mentioned already static and dynamic code analysis. This is the point that you start using commercial products instead of freeware or open source product that you used before. Also, log analysis should be getting better. New security as a service, as I mentioned before. And this is to wrap things up. There are three stages to the startup life. I'm currently wrapping things up. The first stage is startup life. Mature inception to first customers, growing up and adding services and customers, and maturity. For each stage, they're different focused. On the first stage, focused on your application security. Don't make mistakes there. You want to have the right building blocks. Mistake there can be harder to fix. What kind of application security? Mostly around identity management, session management, storing your users' data on a specific location, protected by specific encryption tools. These are all tools for the cloud provider. Make sure that you protect your cloud provider dashboard. And I mentioned two attack vectors that are really popular. Make sure that you monitor them. One is the API keys. Make sure that you don't keep them in your code or in your configuration file. Rotate them periodically. Use temporary tokens if possible. Most of the cloud providers today support it. Second attack vector, your object storage. So many mistakes around object storage. Protect it. Second phase, this is where you beef up your operational security. Make sure that you have good operating security practices, separate between production and development. Make sure that you have good access controls. Make sure that you have good security policies that talk about patch management, backups, out of cloud backups. And for the third stage, make sure that you are transparent to your customer, and when you are transparent, you need to follow everything you said that you are doing. If you you're saying that you're doing disaster recovery and incident response, then you need to do disaster recovery and incident response. So you have to now build it into mature services, and customer will be asking you a lot of questions about it. So make sure that when you prepare your policy, make sure that you are ready to answer those questions. Questions? Somebody from the Facebook Live?
About the key management. It was not clear about the key management.
Okay, key management. In first stage and second stage, you can use the provider key management. For instance, Amazon KMS is a good example. Microsoft has their alternative, Google has their alternative. It basically means that the keys are kept and secured by the provider. You can control the keys. Basically what you can do with the keys is delete them and see who touched them. But they are controlled by the provider and you have limited use of them. At first stage, when you have some more money and you have some bigger customers, enterprises, banks, you might be asked or voluntarily want to move the keys into a more secure location. Because some regulation will say you have to have a unique access to your keys. If the provider have access, is that unique access? You're starting, the question is not that clear. I mean, the answer is not that clear. So you get a question from customers and you don't want a question from customers. You want to tell your customers, this is what I do and this is the best practice. So at this point, you might want to move your keys to somewhere you have more control. This is our security model, HSM. The only reason not to do it before is because it's really expensive. I think HSM in AWS cost about $5,000 advance. That is before your monthly fees. So only when you mature, only when you're getting feedback from your customers, this is where you need to consider going with the keys into a specific HSM. With that said, there are certain regulation. For instance, if you need to comply to HIPAA, United States health laws, go for HSM at earlier stages. Because over there, the question of who is controlling the key is much more acute, is much more important. Any other comments?
My question about backups. Mm-hmm. How to manage backups in the right way? Because I understand that it's calling to ISO or other compliance, you have to put them in different places. So if you have this in Amazon, you should put it in Azure. If you have the Azure, you should put it in other place. Or locally with any device.
Okay. So basically the regulation are not saying that you need to put it in a different provider. Regulation ISO, for instance, will say, not the regulation standard, will say that it has to be 60 kilometers away. Not talking about different providers. Mm. I would say, I would try to put it this way. At the first stage, you can use Amazon. You can Amazon or Microsoft, you can build your services on the same region. Which basically means that you're in the same region and you put it into two different zones. This is where you get a backup that is good for most cases. But it will not protect you if the region will fail, and it will not protect you if somebody is hacking your cloud platform. So first, this is good for stage one. At stage two, stage one, what you do is manually take backups to your, I don't know, to your disk on key. At this point, you don't have a lot of data. So you can do out of the cloud and take it to somewhere on your local storage. On second stage, you need to evolve yourself into a different region, which means that it gives you a better redundancy because one region failed, the other region is alive, but it gives you double operations. You need to operate two regions. At this point, you might want to consider not moving into a different version, not going into a different region with this provider, but going to a different region in another provider. This is where we're mixing Amazon and Azure. But the reason to do so is not regulation, The reason to do so is because if somebody is hacking your Amazon account, you will have your Microsoft as a backup. But it means that you need double expertise. You need to have the expertise for Amazon and Azure. And some startups will not get to that, sometimes never, and sometimes will not get to that even on stage three. So if your architecture is complicated, if you're using a lot of cloud providers and services, this is impossible. If your architecture is a bit abstracted, you can move into two cloud providers and do it basically without many problems. So there isn't a good one solution. Just go as you go. Just go as you go. Make sure that you remember that. If you do backups, protect your snapshots. Snapshots are a great attack vector because they tend to be left out there, and when people poking around, they found an access key, and that's, you know, game's over. Second, remember that there is, you backup your volumes and you backup your data. Snapshot cannot backup your database. You need to have a backup from inside the database, and this backup needs to be protected, and it's a different encryption scheme than using the KMS and the cloud provider. Cloud provider can encrypt your volumes. They're not good in encrypting your own data. So you need to use your database protection mechanisms, which is totally different things. And again, encryption is hard, and backups and encryption makes it even harder.
One more question about investors in the stage two. Mm-hmm. So what is the transparency of cybersecurity on cloud to investors? Do you even pitch to this? Do the investors, do they care? How they approach to it, and what's the approach?
Okay, unfortunately, not many investors are asking about cybersecurity, unless really, your product is really secure, that is about security, and you're approaching customers, approaching investors or into security. But most investors, and correct me if I'm wrong, just don't ask about security. But where do investors come in? Picture when there is noise about security about your company. And this is where they take, this is where they can take back. And this is where you want to protect yourself. So the transparency is not for your investors, they will not ask you about questions. The transparency is to make sure that your customers will be quiet about your security and they trust you, so the noise will not get into your investors. And what do I mean by that? A startup can, I know a couple of startups who had small glitches with customers, a little bit. Not even data was exposed, but the customers were unhappy about some security mechanisms, and they went public in some way over it. Startup lost all fundings because investors cannot differentiate between big security event.
This is what happens with the bug bounties. When you put your bug bounties projects, do you want to be exposed? How do you manage this? It's a whole.
Yeah, but I must say that you can manage your bug. Of course, this is a challenge. Yeah, you want to keep your laundry inside, but you can manage your bug bounty in order to be confidential. If you're using the platforms correctly, it will be effective. Of course, it's adding more risk. This is why I'm saying put it in a later stage. We are talking about stage three, where you are more immune to small faults. But yeah, definitely bug bounty has a other side to that. The side of your company could be in the news. But again, the platforms are getting better, and the way we do it is getting better.
Oshin, you spoke about commercial. There's a question on the web. Mm-hmm. You spoke about commercial software. What's your view on the freeware, open source, or commercially open source type products? I mean, are they?
This is a bigger question than the question of how startup uses. Startup has no choice. I mean, enterprise can choose between a commercial software and a non-commercial software. The problem is today, startups are using a lot of open source software, and we see that there are vulnerabilities intentionally and unintentionally. And this is the problem for the internet, right? Vulnerability in OpenSSL crashed the entire internet, not only startups. A startup has no choice, so it has to use open source software. The question is, the viability. I mean, it's doable, it's possible. make sure that you're ready to replace them if needed. Nothing should be too much into your code. If you're using open source that is too integrated, that is too significant into your code, then don't do open source.
But you also have like that that's doing this for BlickDuck. Yeah, it's actually going through all your open source applications that you do.
Look for vulnerability.
Yeah, so it's kind of good due diligence for us.
Yeah, but the question of open source versus commercial is a bigger than this discussion.
Any other questions?
What about insider attacks? They can be more difficult because if your database administrator takes a copy of the database, the CEO or CTO won't even know about it.
And
for startups, this is a big problem because people leave and go to other companies, and usually data is very valuable.
Also
is there any way?
Also, your IP is very valuable. Malicious insider is something that grown enterprises are having a hard time with. We haven't addressed that because in most cases for a young startup this is not a problem because they're very small, they usually know each other. You know, only at the third stage when they're growing up and adding, you know, a lot of people and could be from different locations, this is where it starts to be a problem. And here is the same problem as a grown-up. So I had nothing specific for a startup. Again, startups are in the beginning they're a bit immune for that because they usually tend to recruit from their own. With that said, protect your IP by contract is mandatory. The problems that a startup are doing because they're recruiting from their own, you know, from their own friends, they fail to do background checks. They fail to sign them up on the right contracts. You know, intellectual property, no competition. Don't give up on those stages. I mean, they are the best defense they have. You will not have. As a startup, you will not have technical defense against malicious insider. Contracts, background checks, make sure that you will not be able to work with your code and say, this is my code. This is usually what happens. Not malicious insider as malicious insider, but somebody is saying, I developed this, I didn't sign any contracts, I'm taking this to the next company, this is something I thought about.
Also important to maintain right, nice, like good branches in your code, in your code repository. To make it right. So many people are just confused about it. So just read about it. There are so many articles about it. Running securely code repository. If you're running it on Git or you're running inside the AWS solution or in any other place.
Yeah, but again, it's very hard from the technical point of view. GitHub and all of those repositories getting the security. But in the end, your developers need access to the code. So your code is exposed. The best way to protect today contracts. There was a raising hand over there.
Yeah. Actually, a lot of startups nowadays they like to use paid service infrastructure like Shopify.
Yeah.
I wonder how secure the platform is.
I cannot say for Shopify specifically, but the rule of thumb goes: the bigger your provider is, the more certification it has, then the safer you are. Go with the big. Go with the most recognized one. Don't be tempted to go with somebody, you know, your friend website, okay? Because there would be double punishment for that. So make sure you're going with the large providers and make sure that you're using their best practices, okay? Which is something that is also important. And I mentioned it in the beginning. I said there is no, I don't want to recommend anybody. There is no reason not to go with Amazon, Microsoft, or Google. Again, I'm trying to go for the big, for the most recognized. And you have to have good reason not to go with one of the things. Anyone else?
Can you elaborate more on the static and dynamic analysis?
On static and dynamic analysis. Basically, a big cornerstone in SDLC, in software development lifecycle, is static analysis and dynamic analysis. Static analysis means that I'm not running the code, I'm reading it. And I'm trying to see, okay, this is an unupdated library. This is over here. You took an input, but you do validation on the code. Okay, you are not running the code. I'm reading it. It's parallel to code review that we had a couple of years ago. Today there are automated tools that are doing it. Basically, what good SDLC practice is: a programmer is developing the code, finished up a piece of the code or a version. He's checking the code into the repository. Automatically, static analysis tool will analyze it, and if it finds a vulnerability that is, let's say, above a high or above medium, he will return the code to the developer. This is the best practice for static analysis. Now, static analysis products are expensive. There are no good open source tools, mostly commercial tools. A popular one is HP45, Checkmarks, and Synopsys. Those are basically the VeraCode, and VeraCode is not much static, more dynamic. So we recommend implementing them at first stage. Expensive, expensive and highly maintained maintenance. Dynamic analysis means that I'm not reading the code, I'm running it, and I'm trying to break it. Push some input into the code, use different encoding, use different characters than what was meant to, and I'm trying to see if I can break the code, make it steal information, maybe do some buffer overflow. Over here, the variety is bigger. There are many open source tools that you can use. Different integration with code deployment tools, you can automate the process. So here we recommend using it in stage two, because you have good open source.
Okay, so we have some pizza. Pizza is here. So stage.